Yeah, so if all of you don't mind, I think we'll just start.
Thank you.
My name is Maitri Deshpande. It is with great pleasure that I would like to welcome Mr. Satish Acharya. He immediately accepted our request to come to Nitte Institute of Communication and talk to all the cartoonists here in Mangalore. Once again, I would like to thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Yeah, it's my pleasure.
Mr. Satish Acharya is a widely acclaimed and also extremely popular cartoonist, political cartoonist, whose cartoons have appeared in various national and international dailies, including Mint, Nitte, the Wall Street Journal, and also the Daily Mail. Jumping straight in, can you please tell us what is the difference between cartooning and simple drawing? Is it a common misconception that cartooning is something like sketching?
Okay. Firstly, my language is cartooning, so please bear with my language. I'm more focused on the political cartoons, editorial cartoons.
Yes.
For me, editorial cartoon is a comment. It's a comment on the news happenings around me.
Yes.
So when you talk about cartooning, there are different aspects. There is comics, there is illustrations, there is caricature.
Yes.
So the whole thing is called cartooning.
Only your field, sir, editorial cartooning, because that is something you are widely known for.
Yeah.
If you could probably tell us how your cartooning is different from, say, just regular drawing or how you prepare yourself in preparing for your editorial cartoons every day?
Okay, it's a complicated process normally. Sometimes ideas come to me. Sometimes I have to search for the idea. Normally every cartoon is ignited by news development. Sometimes there is some terms, some word or some happening which ignites the cartoon, which gives me an idea. Sometimes I have to relate to different aspects of the news related to the same news. Something happened in the past or some symbols or something, some personality.
Okay.
I need to connect with the news to create an idea.
Okay. We see your cartoons in various fields, whether it is politics, the media, cricket,
right,
Bollywood. Which one do you enjoy doing? Earlier,
cartooning was editorial cartooning. It was known as political cartooning.
Yes.
Because the headlines were held by the politicians mostly.
Yes.
Now there is an interconnection. There is politician in sports, cricket especially.
Yes.
And there is Bollywood personalities in cricket as well as in politics.
Yes.
So the headlines are covered by all these people.
Yeah.
So now I call it editorial cartoons, not the political cartoons. I like cricket also, but I enjoy most with the politics because there is more scope because we have lots of colorful personalities in politics.
Okay. Do you think we as readers, when we go through your cartoons, is there any kind of frame of reference we should be putting in to appreciate your cartoon? Do we need some kind of an educational background maybe or similar cultural background to the cartoonist? Or do you think it is something universal? There is no specific training required to appreciate cartoons, editorial cartoons?
Actually, the prerequisite is both cartoonist and the reader, they should be on the same page. If I draw a cartoon on, like a cartoon on Wimbledon, there was the longest tennis match which happened in Wimbledon.
Yeah.
But if you look at the cartoon, you don't get it unless you follow the news.
Okay.
So following the news is very important. Because lots of these editorial cartoons are based on certain news items.
Okay.
And only when you follow that news, you get the idea, the punch behind the idea.
So you do think there is some kind of following the news is good enough to appreciate cartoons?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, there are also other requirements. I mean, you need to be neutral also as a cartoonist. I mean, there are many people who follow cartoons on social media. But in reality, they follow certain leader. They are following certain party or they are fond of certain party or politicians.
Okay.
So that's the reason they follow certain cartoons, certain cartoons.
Okay.
So I don't call them genuine cartoon lovers.
Okay.
Basically, they love their leader or the party.
Okay. Okay, we will come back to that topic a little later. Ramchandra Guha, the author and historian, he has written that in all his readings of autobiographies of Indians, especially political Indians, it's very difficult to find any humor in them. He has remarked that in all his autobiographies of Gandhi, Nehru, Ambedkar, Jinnah, Morarji Desai, Rajendra Prasad, he has not found a single joke. So how has that affected political cartooning in India or editorial cartooning in India, and you especially?
See, now most of the leaders, they don't react to the cartoons. Their followers do, but they don't react. But earlier, I think, even Nehru and other leaders, they are fond of cartoons. I mean, there were instances where leaders called the cartoonist and got the original copy of the cartoon.
Okay.
But now that doesn't happen. I don't know why. Actually, see, I got lots of abuses from the right-wing followers.
Okay.
But Amisha, the leader of BJP, he shares my cartoons, all of my cartoons. I mean, even the critical of his government.
Okay.
And himself also. He shares on his personal website. So I don't know whether it's irony or I don't know what's the strategy, but there is someone who shares those cartoons.
Do you think?
And Akhilesh Yadav, he came up with a book of cartoons,
okay,
which were done on UP government when he was the CM. Okay. And most of them were negative.
Yeah, so since you raised that point, in most editorial cartoons now, we see that they're critical of the subjects they're trying to convey. So as a cartoonist yourself, how do you balance your personal opinion with the topics and individuals you're trying to draw? And is strict objectivity possible? Do you approach that subject with any kind of strict objectivity? Is it even possible while drawing?
No, I try to draw without any bias. That's the basic foundation. I'm mostly critical of the government, whichever government is in power. Before 2014, it was UPA government. I should draw lots of cartoons on the scams of UPA government. Now my focus is on the Modi government.
Yes.
That's the only difference, that's it. I mean, who occupies the chair, it doesn't matter for a cartoonist.
So you
what
are
they do is more important, and I'm more focused on that.
Yeah.
Basically the governance and whatever happened in the strategy, whatever.
So
the social experiments, what do they call it?
Yeah.
I'm focused more on those things.
Since you were talking about social experiments, and do you think political cartoons, editorial cartoons, do they impact average common man citizens? And do you think they impact political discourse in general? I mean, general perception of politics and what is happening in the media because of editorial cartoons?
I'm not sure. I mean, I don't have that illusion. But I hope that gradually it will influence them, sort of, slowly maybe. Because suddenly changing after looking at a cartoon, it's not a good development also.
Okay.
Maybe they should investigate the truth. I mean, they should not go by the cartoon. It can be exaggerated. But it will influence slowly.
Okay.
And I'm not sure about the electoral decision also.
Okay.
Because I don't even tell my wife to vote, so.
Okay. So you do say there is a minor impact, but as readers and as
their opinion could be shaped or reshaped.
Okay. We also often hear that editors and publishers of newspapers, they did not know how to monetize their news on the internet, and many of them complain that because of that they are failing right now. So how do you think editorial cartoonists have adapted to the internet?
You mean monetization?
Not just monetization, generally adapting to the internet now.
I think it's a new medium for us. I mean, after I relocated to my hometown, Kundapur,
yes.
I had to search for different clients also, because once I lose a client, I won't get it in Kundapur. So I use social media extensively.
Yes.
To market, to reach new clients, to reach new readers also. So that helped me, social media helped me. And web portals, news portals, that was a new thing then, and, 6 years back.
Yeah.
So those news portals helped me also. They give more freedom to you compared to print publications.
Yeah.
They interfere less, and they give you more freedom. It's a good thing. I mean, even the social media helped me to reach more people, Because when a certain cartoon is liked by someone, it goes viral. Unlike a news newspaper.
So coming, we'll come back to the viral aspect a little later. But you mentioned the word, I use the word monetization. I also went through your website and I saw that you use Patreon, where readers can contribute directly to you and help support your work. How has it worked out for you, and how do you think it is going to play out in the coming future also?
Actually, I'm not marketing well. I mean, I just started it. My intention was to not to share the cartoon. I mean, I normally share the cartoons with everyone, not just patrons. But I want to give them more, maybe tutorials. Maybe I want to share the first glimpse of the cartoon. Maybe the pencil sketch. Like, I want to give them something different.
How do you think, do you think it is a way forward for cartoonists? You think
it's
a very
popular abroad, actually. Most of the artists use it.
Okay.
Not just cartoonists, most of the other comedians also.
Yeah.
Painters, they use it extensively. And they rely totally on patrons.
Okay.
In India, someone like you could
have. Yes,
you could have. Use it extensively.
Yeah.
It's got lots of support.
Since you brought up virality a little earlier, we saw recently that Abhishek Iyer Mitra, right wing troll, he got some cases slapped against him for inciting violence, and they were basically for jokes on the Konark temple. So now, since you mentioned that your cartoons do go viral, and we've seen that sometimes you have ruffled a few feathers. So, as a political cartoonist, editorial cartoonist now, how do you see yourself dealing with this, coping with this, and also somebody who's been targeted by trolling and threats, how do you deal with all this?
See, earlier it used to affect me. I mean, whenever I used to sit at the drawing board, it used to affect my ideas also. I mean, I used to think whether this idea will affect somebody and offend somebody. And now I'm used to it. And I just ignore those trolls. I just focus on the positive side.
We also saw recently that Sheila Rashid, the JDU politician, she quit Twitter. She said that it is a very unequal playing field, especially she doesn't have any political backing, nobody supporting her, and it's constant harassment all the time. So you mentioned a little earlier that earlier people were okay with your cartoons when you were making it about a certain different topic and your topics changed after a while. What have you seen in these last few years? Any changes through your reception of your cartoons?
See, these cartoons started going viral after Anna's movement. During Anna's movement, they extensively used cartoons on social media. They used to circulate it. And they were mostly about UPS scams. Even my cartoons, they were used by the Anna team. So during those days, even these people just started, Namo Brigade and all. They used to share my cartoons extensively. And those cartoons helped them also. And because after Modi came to power, I had a visitor from Namo Brigade at our hometown. He came and thanked me. He told me that your cartoon also played little role. So after a couple of years, the same person was targeting me for the cartoons of Modi government. So that's the truth. I mean, they don't like being criticized. They don't like it when you criticize the other person. But my job is to criticize the government and whoever is in government.
So
I'm playing the opposition role, that's it.
Yeah, unfortunately, I think somebody mentioned that now cartoonists have taken the mantle of the opposition now in this country.
But we have been failed by the opposition parties.
Do you think also there is something fundamentally about the Indian psyche that we can't take a joke? Have you seen something like that regarding all the abuse you get or the comments or the feedback in general? Do you think there is
maybe they don't like the jokes when it's on them, but they normally share the jokes on other people.
Okay.
Because in cricket, I mean, I've done lots of cricket cartoons. There are cricketers from South Africa and West Indies. They share cartoons on them. Unlike Indian cricketers. I've never seen an Indian cricketer share cartoons on
themselves. Salman Rushdie, another famous author, he, after the Charlie Hebdo attacks in Paris, he mentioned that the most creative cartoons were sometimes also, he found out, they were also the most wicked. Do you agree with that? What is your take on the whole thing?
Maybe, I mean, though we have our own Lakshman Rekha, we work within our boundaries. Sometimes we try to push the boundary. It might happen sometimes. And when ideas go, you don't care about the wickedness.
Yeah. So,
we don't mind offending certain people. I mean, if it's for a certain positive purpose, we should do that. But we have our own boundaries, so we work within that.
So now that you also, you said that on the internet now your cartoons go viral, but at the same time there is this issue that people can't take a joke on themselves.
Yeah.
Do you think this is a fundamental problem of the internet itself now? Is it and cartooning also, is that cartooning is one dimensional? That unlike a text maybe where there are many multiple angles that can be written about, finally cartoon is something we see it and we interpret it immediately. So, do you think anything can be done about this, anything should be done about this, or that is how the medium is and you can't do anything about it?
I think you can't control social media and the net and all. Because people react to visuals immediately. When they read a news, an article, they think about it maybe, they react quite late. But for a visual, they react immediately. And cartoon is an exaggerated form also.
Okay.
I mean, it's more like a satire.
Yeah.
So it affects more people immediately.
Coming back to Rushdie again, he also said that after the aftermath of the Charlie Hebdo attacks, that somehow we excluded religion in our regular everyday talking. And why should religion get a free pass, and while politics or celebrities become fair game for editorial cartoonists? Why should religion get a fair pass? Do you consider religion, you normally stay away from religion, or you don't? Or if you do stay away, why do you stay away?
See, as I said earlier, I have my own boundaries. I mean, in India, most of the cartoons have their own boundaries. And they don't touch religion to provoke people. I don't want my cartoons to incite a riot or something, or kill people. That's the only reason. But we do touch religion. We do draw cartoons on every religion, most of the time.
Okay. Yeah.
I've done cartoons on Islam also, Christianity, Hinduism. But we try to be a little sensitive when it comes to religion.
Yeah.
It should not lead to riots.
Yeah.
That's the only
purpose. That is the Lakshman Rekha thing.
Yeah.
That is the Lakshman Rekha. Since your cartoons now are carried in various international fora thanks to the internet, and they're also read by a global audience, do you think that it has affected your, say, choice of topic or theme? And what does this also mean for local issues, say, Karnataka or Kundapura? Your choice of topics because you're now being read globally. And cartooning in general.
Many people ask me about the cartoons of Trump and other world politics. But we have rich politics here. I mean, we are getting so much masala here in India. So I thought I focus more on India. And since I contribute more to English newspapers and newspapers, I focus on the national politics. And many people ask me, why don't you draw cartoons of Siddaramaiah or Kumaraswamy? I draw, but not regularly, because my clients are mostly English newspapers. They want national news to be covered. That's the only reason. I don't mind drawing cartoons about something happening in Kundapura.
Slightly sidetracking the issue, but coming back to the older topic of you mentioned your clients now are daily newspapers. Are they newspapers?
Mostly news portals.
News portals, yeah. So news portals. So, do you see now that the cartoons have shifted fundamentally from our print media where you used to see cartoons on the front page or at least on the edit page to news portals now?
I think print has very limited space for cartoons. I mean, they can have one cartoon, at the most two cartoons.
But work for this photo, they can hire new people and make space for more cartoonists. That's the reason. And the print, they don't publish on the front page. They normally publish on the
edit page. No, yeah.
And web has more presence. I mean, sometimes they publish it on the what do you call home page also.
Yeah.
That way, I mean, there is more scope for web. There is more visibility also.
So, do you think?
And it's easy for readers to share the.
By being on the web.
Yeah.
So, do you think now the editorial cartoon has seen a new avatar on the internet thanks to the internet now compared to its earlier print edition?
It could be. But most of the newspapers, they have web presence also. They started sharing it on the web.
So you're still, so do you see any change now for
cartooning? I prefer web, like a home freedom.
Compared to print?
Yeah.
Since we know about your unceremonious exit now from Mail Today, you had written a very long Facebook post that also was shared by many news portals now. Do you think that there has been a change from, say, earlier print days to the news portal days and early news portal era from when you started? I think you started for SIFI and
yes.
The news portals then, and now compared to the modern, now like you said, many newspapers have come back to the internet now and they are now doing. So can you tell us, since you have now seen so many changes now from print to early free internet, somebody might call it, to now traditional news media back in the internet. Have you seen any changes in your cartoons for all these mediums?
You mean the changes in?
In your maybe choice of topic or freedom, like you said.
No, I don't do that. I mean, I normally focus on the news. I mean,
no,
when the news breaks, I draw a cartoon.
No, just editorial. Are there editorial restrictions from medium to medium? Have you seen, like, you can't touch these topics, you are allowed to do here, and can you see that change from when you began to now?
Yeah, I get more freedom at news portals, basically.
More freedom?
Yeah, they don't interfere mostly.
Okay.
But in, in web, news portals mostly, and I can react immediately to the news. I can do a cartoon and I can publish it immediately. For the newsprint, I mean, I have to wait for another day to see the cartoon, to share with readers.
Okay.
That's another difference. So with news photos, I can react immediately and draw a cartoon.
Since you mentioned earlier about how there is some amount of support from readers, do you see that as now the future of being an independent cartoonist? You are now no longer answerable to any editor, edit room or newsroom. You can draw what you want and the readers will pay for it.
I still do that.
Okay.
I mean, they don't interfere. That's what I said.
Yeah.
News portal, they don't interfere.
Okay.
They trust me. They trust my choice of subject. They trust my judgment also. And they trust my opinion. That's what matters to a cartoonist. I mean, every newspaper has their own stand. Maybe editor's stand or the owner's stand. So that affects me also. I had a bad experience with Mail Today.
Yes.
So that will affect me. But I've been having a good relationship with the news portals.
Okay. If people wanted to start cartooning now, editorial cartooning, what would be your advice to them? How should one begin? I know we're going to have a workshop tomorrow. That's probably the ideal place to do this. But just for
misconception is that editorial cartooning is about drawing. It's not about drawing. It's about the ideas. Ideas is the king in editorial cartoons. And you should expand your interests. You should not just focus on politics. There are many aspects, and when you expand your interests, you get more ideas. Like you can relate politics to cricket or movies or science.
Okay.
You should read more to expand your interest. Drawing is only a small part. It's just a communication tool.
Mind if we take some questions from the audience also? Yeah, the floor is open to the audience also. Or you can ask any doubts or questions you have to Satish Acharya. I think I can pass the mic around.
Hi, Hello, sir.
Hi.
So you basically said the news is where you draw your cartoons from. In the era of where the fake news is all over us, how do you separate yourself on knowing what is right and wrong?
Okay. I rely on the trustworthy news websites. I don't watch news channels these days. I had made a list of people who are trustworthy. I trust them. I trust those journalists who are trustworthy. I think we should all make that list.
So to make one cartoon, how much time do you take? Starting from your idea, and then you have to check your data and everything.
See, idea takes the maximum time. Actual drawing doesn't take much time. It takes around 30 to 40 minutes, depending on the details involved. Idea takes, sometimes it takes 2 days also. I mean, you read a news, and after 2 days you get a better idea.
But don't you have like
it's a
24/7
job actually.
Yeah, don't you
ideation
have like a time limit? You have to give it like now, a deadline. So how do you cope with that?
See, for the news portals, there is no deadline. Sometimes when news comes at around 11 o'clock in the night, I draw a cartoon. For the newspaper, there is a deadline. I have to send by evening.
Hi, sir. I want to ask you, like, what is your stand on the editorial policies such as drop your cartoon and carry a photograph? And how do you take the criticisms like that? Like, I have seen that you have disabled your review buttons, like, such kind of things. So how do you take that kind of criticisms?
See, normally I respect the editorial decision. I had a good relationship with a mail today, earlier, before the new editor came. There was Abhijit Majumdar. He was a good friend also. He used to work at Nitte. And he was the mail today editor also. So we had our own differences. But there was an opportunity to talk. I could debate with him, I could argue with him. But the new editor was different. I mean, we had differences with the early editor about every cartoon. Most of the cartoons about Modi government or RSS and all. But the new editor was not ready for a talk. He used to make a decision and tell me, change this, change that. So it was not acceptable. I thought he'll change. I waited for a couple of months. Then it was very tough. I mean, so whenever I started to draw a cartoon for Mail Today, it used to affect me. I mean, idea wouldn't be, it was not in a free flow. I had to put some restrictions on the ideas. So it was very tough. And he gave me a choice also. He gave me the choice of for changing the cartoon for that day. But I didn't take the chance. I mean, then he asked me to ask the editorial board to replace with a photograph.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
So do you have any cartoon which is not based on news or media, like has your hobby or something like that?
I didn't get you.
Do you have any?
Non-political.
Yeah, non-political.
I used to draw lots of cartoons earlier, pocket cartoons and all. But after I started contributing to newspapers and web portals, they would demand more cartoons on politics or the news, current affairs and all. I would love to draw more cartoons on other things. I mean, the society, what are happening there.
So basically, like, we have this comic books, like, usually,
like that.
Something sort of.
It's very time consuming, actually. I mean, I draw around 2-3 cartoons every day. It takes my whole day. I get lots of offers to do comics and all. I can't take it. Once I take it, it needs a month or so to do a comic book.
Hello, sir.
Hi.
So, art or comic is always a stereotype that it's a hobby or a passion. Mm-hmm. So, how would you like to enlighten us, like a comic cartoonist as a profession? How we can see that the demand in the industry nowadays? How we can see the comic as a profession?
I would like to differentiate between the comic art.
A cartoonist.
Because in comic art world, there are lots of opportunities. I mean, you can go to animation, you can go to graphic design and all.
But in editorial cartoons, there are not many opportunities. But because of the news portals and websites, you have some space where you can contribute. It will take some time. You won't get results immediately. Because for me, I was not intending to make cartooning as a profession. I did my MBA in finance, and I wanted to get into a better career. But it was, I was passionate about cartooning. So I took this decision to become a professional cartoonist. But it took me around 10 years. 10 years to get a proper column in a newspaper. So it will take time, but you have to be passionate about it. You should back your passion with more efforts, hard work, lots of hard work. Once your name is well known, it's easier to like dictate your terms or demand your own salary.
Hello, sir.
Hi.
I know sense of humor is very important for a cartoonist. So I wanted to ask you, like, even in your personal life, do you have the same sarcasm and sense of humor, or are you a completely different person at home or outside your cartoons?
I'm 24/7 cartoonist.
Okay.
So there is no other Satish Acharya. So whatever you see in those cartoons, I'm a boring person personally, but cartoons are, I hope they're interesting. I mean, they reflect me also. Maybe no, hidden me, but me.
No, I ask this question because a lot of comedy actors are very serious. For example, Charlie Chaplin is very serious when it comes to his personal life.
Yeah.
So that's the reason.
And most of the cartoons are very serious, actually. Most of the cartoons.
Yeah. Thank you.
Any more?
Now they have become more serious, actually.
So you did say about how you react when it comes for political pressure. How does your family react? Because we are all bound with our families and they do restrict us when we want to do something on our own. So what's your take on that?
Actually, till the mail today thing happened, my wife didn't know about all these things actually. And she came to know about it and she said, why don't you draw cartoons on cricket and other things? That's the reaction. But I stay in Kundapur, it's quite safe, I guess. Unlike in Mumbai, they have to avoid their morning walkings.
Have you come across any defamation or have you dealt with any?
Pardon?
Defamation? So, cases?
Not directly, maybe the newspaper. I'm not sure. I need to check with them.
Hi sir.
Hi.
I just want to know about the competitions in your line of profession. So what are the difficulties you face and with whom you compete?
Okay. See, till you establish your name, there is lots of competition. You have to compete with everyone. Once you have your own name, established name, you are your own competition. There is no competition. Because most of the cartoonists, they are very distinctive in their ideas, in their drawing style, in their thoughts also. So they can't compete with each other. You can't compare one cartoon with another one. So there is no competition, I guess. But when you're a newcomer, I mean, you have to compete for opportunities.
So when it comes to doing cartoons or anything for that matter, who do you consider as your role model?
See, I started with R.K. Lakshman and Mario Miranda. I used to draw copy day cartoons. R.K. Lakshman was like, he was more realistic style. He had more realistic style. I never understood his the humor in it or the message in his cartoons. But I used to like his cartoons. And Mario Miranda also. I mean, his cartooning style is very distinctive. He used to fill his cartoons with lots of details. It was tough to copy him because there were lots of details. But I used to copy his characters. He had very distinctive characters. So those two people are my role models. But I get inspired by many cartoons over there. Still I get inspired by many cartoons. Even the younger cartoons also.
Any more questions?
question.
Yeah.
Like, so what is your stand on these trolls and memes nowadays? Because I feel like they are not using that much creativity compared to a cartoonist, but they are influencing people more. Like, people are nowadays getting all such news through all these trolls and memes. So how it's challenging for a cartoonist, like, for you, the trolls and memes that are being today?
See, some people consider cartooning as a troll also. I mean, trolling some political party or leader. We have lots of competition now, because when we work on certain idea, and by the time we finish that idea with a cartoon, you see another troll coming up with some idea, I mean, similar image or something. So there's a lots of competition that way. Otherwise, we normally think visually, unlike other people who think verbally. So we think visually, so we have some advantage, I guess, as a cartoonist.
Hi sir, how do you prioritize your news? Because you told now that you take so like 2 days or something to ideate things. So how do you prioritize when you have two news in your hand? Like say, we had say the farmer protests that were happening in Maharashtra. On the other hand, we had the Tripura CM Biplab Deb giving blabbering things. So how do you prioritize news? Like, we could obviously see that what the comments that Tripura CM made went viral, while some grave issues that the farmers were protesting for could not get that much, it did get attention. So when such things happen, how do you prioritize your news? Like, what you want to make cartoons on?
So I normally don't take 2 days for a cartoon. I mean, sometimes it happens. I mean, sometimes I feel that I should draw a cartoon on a certain topic, and it takes some time. Otherwise, most of the cartoons are spontaneous. When you hear a news, when you read a news, you come up with an idea. And I normally focus on the serious issues, mostly. And sometimes you don't get an idea, because you want to do a cartoon on a certain topic, but you don't get an idea. So you avoid it. That's it.
How was the transition from paper to digital? Was it very difficult? Was it very easy? How was it?
Okay, you are talking about the drawing style?
Yes, yes.
Okay. I think I needed it, because I was doing around 2-3 cartoons every day. It was taking the rendering time, it was taking lots of time. So I thought I should migrate to a digital thing. It's more convenient. I still miss the paper thing. I practice with the paper and pen and pencil, but this gives me more options digital, and it's faster, it saves my time. I think it's for a professional cartoon, it's required.
So do you use the conventional mouse, or do you use a graphic tablet? How's that?
I use a Wacom Cintiq.
Okay.
Yeah. I used to draw with mouse also.
How long does it take for you to draw a cartoon now, sir, with the digital apparatus you have now?
It takes around 30-40 minutes maximum.
That's after you have the idea already?
Yeah, there is no time restriction. Sometimes it's spontaneous, sometimes it takes time. The best ideas were spontaneous.
Content creators or creatives, basically, like a painter or someone, we have our writers also. They face this problem called creative block. So have you?
I can't afford it.
So have you gone through a creative block?
No, I can't afford it. That's the problem. Yeah. Because I have to survive. I need to do a couple of cartoons every day. So sometimes my cartoons are not that good. I knew that, but I have to do some cartoons. So. But I try to maintain my standard. I try to be different. I don't settle with the first idea normally. I try to improvise it.
And when you put up your cartoon and people expect, when there is a very good cartoon and the next cartoon is not that good and people expect something better every time, right? How would you give that?
See, earlier I used to follow this Facebook or social media yardstick as a success of any cartoon. But I realize that it's not truth. I mean, someone at Facebook, they decide which cartoon or which image goes viral. So you can't depend on the success or likes or the comments or the shares. Of course, there are certain cartoons which are actually quite good. They go viral naturally. But there are many cartoons which are, they don't go viral. They're good also. Cartoons find them good, but they don't go viral. They won't be liked by many people.
Sir, do you have published any book related to cartoon?
I've done three, four collections of my cartoons. The first one was during 2014 elections. Then there was one on cricket. And then one cartoon book on demonetization. I had around 90 cartoons in that book. Thanks to Modi.
So your cartoon on the Charlie Hebdo attack got international attention. So how was that whole response and what kind of feedback?
I was quite surprised actually, because that was just my reaction to the massacre. And it went viral. I mean, many people liked it. That's the power of internet and the social media. There is no boundary. A good cartoon or a cartoon which is liked by many people, it goes viral. I felt good. I mean, I was contacted by many publications abroad. I had one interview with the BBC. They were talking about freedom of expression. I told them that we have our own boundaries. And they were shocked. Because they believe in uninterrupted freedom of expression, unlike in India. So it was quite different dealing with these people.
So on a lighter note, so you just said that when he spoke about demonetization, you were like, thanks to Modi ji, you made 90 cartoons. So does that mean that more the problems, more you make cartoons and more the profit you make?
Yeah, cartooning is we call it negative art. But for a positive future, a positive change, that's what we call it. I mean, we are hoping for a better future. But we are happy with the present also. I mean, it's our Achyedin.
Yeah, hope Achyedin continues.
If you avoid the social media backlash, it's Achyedin.
Thank you, sir.
On that note, I think we would like to wind up our interview today. Thank you so much, sir, for spending time with us. I would like to remind everybody that Mr. Satish Acharya's workshop is open still for people who are interested. It's a one-day workshop. All the materials are provided. So if anybody is interested, they can register today. It's from 9:30 to 4:30 tomorrow.
10, no?
We are asking them to come by 9:30. Yeah. I mean, you can join us by 10, it's fine. Let them be able to come. 9:30. Lunch is also provided for participants who want to participate in the workshop. So please let the organizers know by today evening if you're interested. There are still a few spots open. So please make use of this opportunity. Once again, thank you very much, sir.
Thank you so much.
We hope to see you tomorrow again. Thank you.